I could. And I wanted to play for those young children, but you know what? Those voices, the raw voices. The raw voices.
Jesus.
The anointing was there. Keep on singing. Keep on singing. Keep on singing. God is with you. I give honor to God tonight. If you don't mind, I'd like to walk around just a little bit. I give honor to God tonight because He is definitely in this building. As an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, I come to you first in the name of Jesus Christ, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Israel. His name is Yahweh, the Lord is one. Father of our Lord and Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, who we call Jesus Christ. The Holy Ghost is definitely in the building tonight. I'm going to tell you why, because not only can I feel Him, but I see Him. Thank God tonight for your woman of God. Y'all come on, y'all can believe it in that. She is the son of this house. Thank God for you. Thank God for you. I was looking all over the church and just looking at the, you know, the decor, and I'm like, oh my goodness, it is beautiful in here.
Amen.
Pastor Council, I thank God for our meeting. Yes. Thank God for our connection.
Yes.
And it's funny, you know, you came in during the time, and the reason why you were there for water. And I kept thinking about Jesus and the woman at the well.
All right.
And we were talking about that scripture, the day you came in, and I just, I'll never forget, there is a divine appointment. God set it up.
Yes.
He set it up. It's the beginning of some great things to come.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank God for my apostles in Goldsboro, North Carolina. Apostles Edwin Vaughn. Edwin Vaughn is from Impact Religion of Impact Church Goldsboro. Impact Church Goldsboro family. I'm from Goldsboro originally. And I live here in Fayetteville. Been in Fayetteville for about 10 years now.
All right.
I was once stationed at Bragg. I was in the military at one point, military police. And worked with the sheriff's office, Cumberland County, for a while. And got tired of that. And now I'm here at DuPont, you know, working as a security supervisor. And that's where I met your woman of God. And I see some other faces that comes out there to get water. And I just want y'all to know, when they come out there, they come in spirit.
Amen.
They come in the right spirit.
All right.
They do. I'm telling you, I know God is with these people that come out there. I can tell. I can see. Yeah. You know, light recognize light.
Amen.
So just know, I saw you. Oh, yeah. Amen. So I just want to thank God for my wife, Prophet Tanya McNair. You know, I was going to ask her to sing for me. She normally sings for me. But I said, no, you know what? I don't want to belabor the service. I just want to go ahead and get up. And I sat there as long as I could. And, I wanted to get up there. And I said, you know what? I don't want to, because I haven't played in a while. And the kind of music that I play is a little bit different. I don't play a lot of the modern stuff. I'm still kind of old school. You know? But I thank God anyway. So there is a word tonight. Do you have your Bibles?
Amen.
Amen. The word of the Lord tonight, and I promise you, I will not be before you long. Did you hear what I said?
Yeah.
I will not be before you long. But it doesn't take God all night to say what He has to say. So we're going to release the service in the hands of the Holy Spirit.
All right.
And allow Him to speak the word on tonight. The subject for tonight is I will do a new thing.
All right. Thank you, God.
I stopped by here to tell you that God is saying that he is going to do a new thing. A new thing in the pastor. A new thing in your elders. A new thing in your mothers and deacons. A new thing in your choir, your musicians. A new thing in this sanctuary. A new thing in this community. A new thing in this city. God is getting ready to do a new thing. I came by here because, you know, I have a reputation of tearing up stuff. And what I mean is I upset principalities.
Amen.
I make powers and rulers of darkness mad. I disturb darkness. Because I bring light. And I bring the light of the word of truth. That's going to make us free. Amen.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Thank you, God.
In the book of Genesis,
thank you, Jesus.
Chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, it reads,
amen.
In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth.
Yeah.
I'm going to stop right there. First of all, we know that God is a holy God. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
God is a perfect God.
Yes.
He makes no mistakes.
That's right. Amen.
He doesn't get confused.
That's right.
He knows exactly what he's doing,
yes.
How he's going to do it,
yes.
When he's going to do it,
yes.
Where he's going to do it,
that's right.
And who he's going to do it through.
Right.
God knows everything, and he cannot lie.
That's right.
He cannot make a mistake.
That's right.
He is too pure, too holy,
yes.
Too
yes,
wise.
Yes.
Lord God Almighty.
And there is none like him.
None.
Nobody like him in the earth,
no,
in the heavens, or under the earth.
That's right.
So how can a holy God, in the beginning, create heaven and earth and do it right the first time?
Mm-hmm.
And then in verse 2, the earth is without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And then the Spirit of God had to hover over the face of the water. Something happened in between verses 1 and 2. How many of you know that the Bible is not in chronological order? It's not. You have to search around. You have to dig. You have to do research. Amen? It's not in chronological order. So, if you don't mind walking with me through the scriptures, because I love walking through the word.
Amen.
Because there has to be scripture to validate every point.
Amen.
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 So, verses 1 and 2. He creates heaven.
Mm-hmm.
You know he's perfect. He did it right the first time.
Amen.
Right?
That's right.
But in verse 2, everything is messed up. There's chaos. There's nothing here. Everything is out of order. What happened? I'll show you what happened. In Ezekiel chapter 28, we read how Lucifer, the son of the morning, Lucifer, the angel or the archangel or the cherub that covered the mercy seat of God at one time. It talks about how he was dressed, how he was covered in all of the stones of fire. And let me take this time to give honor to God for all the elders and the clergy. Amen.
Amen.
But he was covered in all the stones of fire.
Yeah.
Lucifer.
Yes.
Wise. He was a musician, a praise and worship leader.
Yeah.
He was the Hammond organ. He said pipes and tabrets and stuff was coming up out of him. So he was the Hammond B3 organ, and I really believe that God anointed that organ.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Listen to me. Ezekiel chapter 28 talks about how he was perfect in his ways until iniquity was found in him. What does that have to do with God doing a new thing? Everything. Let me show you how.
Thank you, Jesus.
Iniquity was found in Lucifer. Why? Where did it come from? What is iniquity? We think iniquity is just another level of sin, right? But listen to me. Alata is the Aramaic word for iniquity. Alata. It means a sin of the soul. It is what we know as wounded emotions. hurt feelings, bitterness sets in, malice, and then hatred, and then murder. All these things were working in Lucifer. But why? Why? What? Why did he have hurt feelings? Why was his feelings hurt? Why did he have wounded emotions? Why did he become bitter? Why did that particular star, and you know in the Bible, angels are referred to as stars. In the book of Revelation, we see this. Why was this star suddenly turning inward into himself? He collapsed in on himself because of his iniquity. His mind bent. His attitude changed. He once was straight, but he started bending and twisting and became like wicker furniture, where we get the word wicked from, because it twists and turns. He became bent. But there was a reason why. And the reason why is because Revelation chapter 12, verses 7 through 9. He was the angel that covered the mercy seat. If you look at the Ark of the Covenant, you see two angels, one on each side. Lucifer was the angel that covered a mercy seat, the mercy seat of God, meaning he was right there. He was a seraphim, a burning one. He was like God. But see, you gotta understand, this earth that we're living on is not the original earth. This earth was here before. How do we know this? Because archaeologists and paleontologists are finding bones in the earth, fossils of these big giant creatures that lived here once upon a time. We call them dinosaurs. Could man and dinosaurs live on the earth at the same time? Not like you and me, no. But angels could. Let me tell you how I know this. Because Lucifer, in Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 15, it talks about, he said, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. Where there's a throne, there is a king, right? So what did he rule? Where was he ascending from? This place. I'm saying all this to show you something here. He said, I'm going to go up and I'm going to be like the Most High. I'm just as powerful as he is. See how warped he is now? You see, you got to understand, when we have friends and somebody that's really close to us, we share secrets. And things that you are working on, I am privy to, not like everybody else who may not know. Lucifer, this angel, knowing the plan of God to create man in his likeness and give him dominion over the earth, Lucifer didn't like that too well. That's my place. You want to give him all this power? Dirt? Dirt? You want to put your power in dirt? I'm made from fire. I'm made from your loins, he thought. This is Lucifer talking. And God all the while is saying, but you don't understand. I'm going to do a new thing. Because he knew that iniquity would be found in that one. He knew the plan of that particular star, that he would try to get another third of the angels to follow him, to overthrow him. He already foreknew. But God is saying, I'm going to do a new thing. Yeah, you know that I'm going to form man of the dust of the clay. You got that. And I'm going to put my spirit in him. And I'm going to give him dominion over that, which you're over now. Wounded emotions. Why am I telling you this? Because sometimes We don't like it when God exalts someone else over us. We get hurt feelings, wounded emotions. We become bent. We change personality, attitude, just change. Now you're bitter. Now you're acting different. Now you're withdrawn. You collapsed in and on your own emotions, in on yourself. And that's what a black hole is. It's a dying star, a star that collapsed in on itself. And light cannot escape it. Anything gets in it is lost forever. That's what happened to Lucifer. Once bright in the morning star, now a black hole. And in him is darkness. In him is darkness. But I come to tell you that there is a light.
Yes.
And that light's name is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And if you have him in your mind, in your soul, in your heart, there is no darkness that can conquer you. There is no darkness that can take a hold of your mind. There is no darkness that can bend or twist you. No darkness will have control over your emotions. I'm here to tell you that the seat of the soul, the mind, the will, the intellect, the emotions, that is where demons like to hang out.
Yes.
And
yes. That's right. Amen.
Jesus Christ came to save what? Our soul.
Yes.
He came to save your mind. He came to save your will. He came to save your intellect, your emotions. To deliver your emotions. To deliver you from emotional bondage. Some of us have been hurt by darkness, dark situations, dark relationships. You've been hurt. Been mistreated. Been done wrong. Been lied on. Talked about. And the enemy have played with your mind long enough. It's time now to say enough is enough. Turn to the light. Don't give way to the darkness. Turn to the light. Turn on the light. Turn on the light. How do we turn it on? By turning to the light. I need to tell you something tonight because there is something that's going on. Listen, there was a war that was in heaven. Listen, when Lucifer and the third of the angels decided, okay, let's go on up there and do what we got to do and claim what's rightfully ours. God already knew what was going on. And the Lord had Michael the archangel and all of his hosts to just kick them back down to where? Where did they go? Earth.
Amen.
Now go to verse 2. And then the earth was form and void. Amen. And darkness was upon the face of the deep. You see? Something happened between verses 1 and 2. The war in heaven. How do we know? Jeremiah chapter 4 verses 23 through 26. It talks about how the cities were broken down at the fierce anger of the Lord. How the fruitful place became a wilderness. What happened? That's the result of the fall of the angels. Amen. And Lucifer.
Hallelujah.
And the Lord had to say, let there be light.
Yes.
He said, I got to do a new thing. Let me start over. Let there be light. And there was light. And he saw the light, and it was good. How many of you know that the light of God is good? Jesus Christ is good. Better than anyone can ever be to us. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. We serve a mighty God. God said, I got to begin again. The reason why I had to give you that backdrop is to help you to understand some of the things that you may have been going through, some of the things that you have gone through and are going through right now. There's a word for you.
Thank you.
There's a word for all of you.
All right.
But I came to speak to you tonight. Y'all can listen in if you want to.
Amen.
But the Lord is saying,
thank you, Lord,
that I will do a new thing.
Right.
Why? Because the enemy has looked at you and said, look, I can't stand them. They look too much like God. Don't you know that you are God's?
Yes.
And all of you are children of the Most High.
That's right.
Satan wants you to look. Satan wants you to look at this particular word like this dude lost his mind. Where did he come from? That's what the devil wants you to do, because he don't want you to receive the truth, because the truth in this thing is going to make you free.
Yeah.
I promise you that your life will never be the same again after tonight. It has nothing to do with this flesh. It has everything to do with the glory that's dwelling on the inside. Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, Yeshua, the Messiah.
That's it.
Thank you, Jesus.
He came to save your soul.
Yes.
He came to save you so you can get some sleep at night.
Yes.
Walking around, pacing the floor, wetting your pillow, trying to figure out how you're going to pay this bill, how you're going to pay that bill, how you're going to do this, how you're going to do that. Your soul is not at rest. You don't have any peace. Why? Because the light ain't on. Turn the light on. How do you do it? You speak the word of God.
Turn it on.
Speak it. Speak the word only. Don't speak what you see with your natural eye. Speak what you see in the word of God.
Amen.
That is the only thing that is going to liberate you and me.
That's right. Amen.
I had to let you know that the devil, the same way he operated back then, he ain't got no new game. He's still doing the same thing over and over and over again. What we need to do is get in this word and find out what it says about who we are and begin to walk in our authority. We need to walk as kings and priests, as prophets. We need to walk as warriors with our head held high, our chest out, knowing that God has got my back. When we enter a room, demons ought to get nervous. When we go into a place, devils need to start fleeing. The devil needs to try to find the exit sign because they see you coming. That's the kind of authority that we need to be walking in. Let me tell you, the Lord says, I will do a new thing. Why? Because the enemy has looked at you.
Yes.
He's looked at your life.
Yes.
He began to manipulate and orchestrate certain events
yes.
to cause you to make bad choices,
amen.
Wrong decisions.
Yes.
And then you live in regret, saying, my God, I wish I wouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have said that. Man, I should have done this.
Yes.
You don't want to live in coulda, woulda, shoulda.
That's it.
You don't want to live in regret, but see, the enemy wants you to live there. Because it's only in regret that you can't get what God has for you.
Yes.
It's only in regret that deception dwells. Because regret says that you will never be what you need to be. Regret says that you will never reach that point that you want to reach. Regret says you will never have enough money to do or go where you need to go. Regret says, I'm not what I want to be. And chances are I'll never become what I need to be. Regret will cause you to look at other people and have bitterness, anger, jealousy, envy, because you see someone else doing good, reaping benefits of the word of God. You see somebody else coming up, as they say. You see someone else prospering.
Yeah.
And then that little sting come in your chest. And you wonder, man, what's wrong with me?
Yeah.
I should have done this. If I would have finished school, if I would have taken this class, I would have gotten that certification. If I would have done this, if I wouldn't have seen him, if I wouldn't have been with her, if I wouldn't have done this or that. Listen, get rid of that mentality.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Put it away from you.
Yes.
Because that in itself is bondage.
Yes.
It is a new day. Stop regretting. Stop feeling sorry for yourself. Get up and do something. It's not enough just to speak the word. It's not enough just to proclaim and declare. You gotta actually, physically, literally do something. Get to work. We have been teaching and preaching for years. Just have faith. Just believe the word of God. Just speak it and proclaim it, and God will do it. And some of us are wondering, well, when are you going to do it? I ain't seen nothing yet. I'm still speaking. I'm still believing. Do I have a witness? I know. I was there. Speaking, proclaiming, declaring, prophesying. Still, nothing's happening. It ain't happening fast enough. What's going on? What's wrong with my faith? What is wrong? Why isn't it happening? I'm going to tell you why. And I spoke this particular word last week. There is a connection between faith. See, faith has a partner. The partner of faith is forgiveness.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, sir.
When you have unforgiveness in your heart, you can believe all you want to. It's not going to happen.
That's right.
I don't care how much faith you have. You have, I know it sounds sacrilegious, but it's the word of God.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
Because if you have unforgiveness, listen, in Matthew 18:18,
you
see how it says, whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loose in heaven. Whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven.
Yeah.
Well, the Lord said, if you fail to loose your brother or your sister on earth, then I'm not going to loose your blessings in heaven. If you keep your brother and sister bound on earth, then guess what? I'm going to keep your blessing bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. We got to do it down here first. On earth. See the manifestation of the glory of God in operation in our lives the way we should. We're living beneath our privileges. We should be further along in our faith. All we got to do is let it go.
Let it go.
I know it hurt. And you say to yourself, I got a right to be angry. I got a right to be mad. What they did was wrong. They know it was wrong. I'm justified. I'm justified at being angry. I'm justified at holding them in this little prison. I'm justified at keeping them captive. Guess what? The Lord said, you got to let that go.
Let it go.
You got to let it go. The reason why, listen, if God is going to do a new thing, we got to let go the old thing. If God is going to do something new, you got to release that which is old. Required in us first. We gotta let some stuff go. And see, this is how the enemy plays with us. This is how the enemy controls, manipulates us. He gets us thinking about stuff that's taking place in our lives. Things that have happened, things that didn't happen, that should have happened. And then he gets us wallowing in our little pity party, or you know, we get two or three people that'll, you know, help us out and pat us up and, you know, say, you know what, you're right. You should feel that way. You should. You know what? Those people right there don't mean you any good.
Amen.
I'm trying to tell you, you need some people around you that's going to kick you and say, look, you need to get up from there. You need to turn to the God of your salvation. You need to begin to speak the word of God. You need to stop feeling sorry for yourself. Get up and do something.
Amen.
Do what? Do something new. Something different. Something different that you've never done before. But we're too afraid. We're scared. We're scared to do something new. That's what's holding us up, and particularly us as African American people. Because of our history. Because of the struggles, if you will, because of it's a post-slavery mentality that is still hanging around our mind that causes us to not step out into new territory.
That's right.
That causes us not to take risks.
You got to learn
to do something different.
Amen.
I'm talking to somebody tonight. Because the Lord has been dealing with you about doing something different, and you've been too scared to do it because you're afraid of what somebody's going to say. You're afraid of how somebody's going to take it or how somebody's going to look at you.
Yeah.
Who cares? Right. You shouldn't. Because they are not going to be responsible for your tomorrow.
Amen.
They are not going to be responsible for your destiny.
That's right.
You are responsible for your own destiny.
Amen.
What you say today is a result of what you said yesterday. What you do tomorrow is going to be a result of what you say and do today.
Amen.
So,
Lord, I thank you, Jesus.
Kids, school age, you in middle school, high school, get your education. Go to school.
Yeah.
Go to college. Further yourself. Get your education, because we're living in a society where a bachelor's degree is looked at as a high school diploma.
Amen. That's right.
You've got to at least have a master's.
There you go.
In order to get somewhere. At least. Remember that. This is what the word of the Lord is saying. Mm-hmm. And I'm getting ready to sit down. Mm-hmm. Isaiah chapter 40. And I know you're probably saying, well, you know what? He ain't read one scripture. I was in the Word the whole time. Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 5. And this is where we're going to get the meat of the message. The Bible reads, matter of fact, let's read that one. Let's read that one, because you got to see this one for yourselves. Isaiah chapter 40, uh-huh. verses 1 through 5, and it reads, after the enemy has toyed with your mind, after the enemy has sent assassins into your life to kill your dreams, after the enemy has risen up against you on your job and sabotaged your work, after the enemy has hurt you in relationships, after the enemy has done things to you that nobody else knows about but you,
yes, Lord.
Things that happened when you were a child that you never forgot, after the enemy has told you that you're not smart enough, you don't have enough money, you're not popular enough, after the enemy has kept you in poverty and said that, you know what? It's just how it is. This is life.
Thank you, Jesus.
No. The Lord said, comfort.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Comfort ye. Comfort ye my people. That's why I'm here tonight.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you.
God is bringing you comfort.
Amen.
You've been uncomfortable for a long time.
Yes.
You've been at war. There's been a war in your house. There's been war in your family. There's been war in your own mind.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, God.
But this is what God is saying. Comfort ye my people, saith your God. Speak comfortably to Yerushalayim, and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished. God told me to come by here tonight and says that the war is over. You've been fighting long enough. God says that your war is ending. The warfare against this house is ending. You got witches around here, but the warfare is ending.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, yeah, I knew it when I crossed over into this county.
Oh, my Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
The war is ending.
Thank you, God.
Your suffering, mental and emotional suffering.
Thank you, God.
is coming to a close.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
It's coming to an end. The Lord sent me here to bring comfort to you. To speak comfortably to you. To let you know that your warfare, your suffering is coming to an end.
Thank you, God. Glory to God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Listen to the word of God. Not only is your warfare accomplished, but that your iniquity is pardoned.
Oh, man.
God is excusing your emotional dilemma. God is pardoning. He is forgiving your hurt feelings and the way you've gotten bent out of shape when certain things didn't go your way. He's forgiving.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Jesus.
You see, and I'm hearing it right now. I see it. Woman of God, the Lord just said,
Hallelujah.
You got people around you who love you.
Thank you, God.
But you also got a couple of people who are rebellious.
Thank you, Jesus.
God is saying that this word tonight
Thank you, God.
Is going to bring a reform.
Thank you, Jesus.
The Lord is saying to you that if there is anything in your heart that is not right, you need to repent. Because if you do not repent, hear me well, then you'll stay in that wilderness for the next 40 years, circling around, and you won't be able to get out. But comfort is here. Peace is coming. That's what God is saying. Peace is coming. Because of your prayers, because of your intercession, because of your fasting, because of your heart to do the will of God, He's going to send you peace, comfort, and your warfare is not only going to end, but God is going to begin to send warring angels to post inside and outside this church.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Oh, hallelujah.
There's some people around here who don't like this church being here.
My, my, my.
But they can't touch it.
That's right. That's right.
They've tried already. But they can't touch it. Hear what I'm saying? Don't be fearful.
Amen.
This is the word of God.
That's right.
Know that the Spirit of the Lord is here.
Amen.
I knew it when I walked in here and heard those beautiful voices singing. The Spirit of the Lord is truly here.
Yes, sir.
But in order for the Lord to stay, we have to keep the lights on.
Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
I ain't talking about those lights.
No, sir.
You got to keep your lights on.
Yes,
and the way we keep our lights on, we got to stay in prayer.
Amen.
Yes.
Pray, 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 pray. We gotta pray, intercede, fast, turn down the plate, turn the TV off, turn the radio off, get off Facebook, get off social media, get off your cell phones, and seek the Lord. That's how we keep the lights on. Amen. Watch this. And I'm closing with this. The Lord said, yes, I'm sending comfort. I'm ending your warfare and your suffering. I'm bringing you peace. And He said, as a result of that, every valley shall be exalted. Every mountain and hill shall be made low. The crooked places shall be made straight and the rough places plain. What is He saying? Every low place. You've been in a low place. Get out of the low place. He said, that day is over. I'm doing a new thing in you, God said. I'm doing something new. I'm getting ready to lift you out of your low place. And all those mountains and hills that you've been able to go around and climb, He said, I'm going to make them low. Those crooked twists and turns, God said, I'm going to make it straight for you. The rough places, I'm going to smooth it out. It's not going to be as hard as it used to be. God is saying, I'm going to make the way easy. Easy. He said, I'm going to get you God. Because you are keeping prayer in this house. Because you are keeping the altar lit with the fire of God. He said, I'm going to lift you up out of your low place. I'm going to bring out every mountain and hill. I'm going to make the crooked places straight and all the rough places. I'm smoothing them out. It is going to be easy. God said, I'm making the way easy. That is the word of the Lord for this house tonight. Comfort. Comfort. And I see some sickness here. I see some ailments in the body. I see it. 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 God is saying what you need to do. Listen to me, high blood pressure. Listen to me, sugar diabetes. Listen to me, arthritis. Listen to me, migraines. Listen to me, joint pains, gout. Listen to me. God, he's seen you suffering. You've been to your doctors. I know I'm going to walk into the office of the prophet tonight, but I'm just going to follow the Spirit. God says, first of all, yeah, you've been to your doctors. They diagnosed you. Somebody with their eyes. Your eyes. You have trouble with your eyes. God said, listen, first thing you need to do, you got to change the way you eat. Oh, that wasn't me, was it? Change your diet. That's God. We're ruled, controlled by our taste buds. Our taste buds tell us what to eat because it's so good. There's something about the fat on oxtails. There's something about fried chicken. There's something about, I mean, y'all know what I'm talking about. There's something about it. It's good. But it's not good for us. It's not good for the body, especially when you've already been diagnosed and you know you have a problem and you continue to eat the things that you shouldn't, you're killing yourself. You're committing suicide. You're telling the Lord, God, I don't respect this body you gave me. I don't really regard this temple. This is the temple of God. This, we are the ecclesia. Yes. We are the church, and the kingdom of God is in you and me. Yes. It's in us. Yes. So in order for us to do the things that we need to do for God in our full strength, we need to eat better.
Thank you, Jesus. Eat better. Thank you,
Jesus. That's the word of the Lord. It's not deep. It's just simple and plain. Eat the right foods.
Amen.
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 Now, every eye is going to see when the glory of the Lord comes, because when he makes it smooth, his glory is going to show up. After he gets rid of those mountains and hills, after he lifts you up out of your low places, after the Lord begins to make those crooked places straight and the rough places plain, his glory is going to show up. But listen to this. It wasn't until after everything was made smooth, straight, and plain that his glory showed up. So the reason why glory ain't showing up like it should is because you're still in a low place. The reason why glory ain't showing up is because you still running around that mountain. The reason why glory can't show up is because some of us are bent. We're not straight. The reason why glory don't show up is because we're rough around the edges. Sometimes we're too rough with our fellow man. Watch the way you talk to people. Watch the way you treat people. You hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
But we want the glory to show up after we done fuss somebody out. We want the glory to show up after we done cuss somebody out in our mind. You may not have said it, but in your mind, you done cussed them out. Up and down. Road rage. Somebody cut in front of you. You that close. And some of you letters, it done slipped out anyway. You Lord, forgive me. It's a hard issue. It's a heart issue. Whatever comes out of your mouth is a result of what's in your heart. And see, listen, glory shows up here first.
Yes.
Did you hear what I said?
Yes.
Glory, the glory of God, the Shekinah of God, the Kabod, the weight and the presence and the essence of the Holy Ghost of Ruach HaKodesh, it shows up here first.
Yes.
Before it spills out into the earth. We're expecting to see a cloud, a big light, just show up in front of us. It's not going to show up if it didn't happen in there first. Where's the cloud in you? Where's the light in you? Where's the fire in you? When we, in our heart, begin to get out of our low places, when we, in our hearts and our minds, begin to humble ourselves before the mighty hand of God. When we, in our hearts and our minds, get straight and walk straight. When we, in our hearts and our minds, begin to be a smooth operator. Talk, walk like the Messiah. Don't go into the things of the world and be like the world and act like the world and talk like the world. We're supposed to be different. What happened to the separation? What happened to come out from among them and be yourself? What happened to that? I know the old saints used to say it all the time, you know, be holy. But being holy ain't mean either. You can be holy and not be mean.
That's right. Amen.
You, I mean, come on. A scribe on your face in the name of Jesus. Okay, no, you defeat the whole purpose. The Spirit of the Lord is gentle and meek. Listen, I love this right here. And I saw this when I first came in. And now these things, these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these three is love.
Amen.
I want you to stand to your feet because this is the end of the message. My delivery is a bit unorthodox, I know. But I will have you know that the Lord has spoken. And the Lord wants you to know that he wants to do a new thing. He's going to do a new thing. He's doing it even now. Right now. It's already in motion. It's all, the ball is already rolling. A new thing. I see it. Oh my God, you want to expand. This ain't it. It's not. No, this is not it. It's a good start, but it's not it. God is you're going to grow. You're going to grow. And the Lord is going to give you the grace to reach people that you've not been able to reach in times past. God is going to bring new faces, new families, families.
Hallelujah.
We're your intercessors. We're your prayer warriors. Those who you call on to pray and to intercede and to do warfare. Hallelujah. You're prophetic individuals. You all need to stand by this woman of God. Continue to do what you've been doing, but increase it up a notch. Just step up a notch.
Amen.
All right? Because God wants to bring you into a place where you see the enemy from afar off so that you won't be caught off guard.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Oh, yeah. Prophecy is going to come in this house even stronger. The spirit of prophecy, and I wake it up right now in the name of Yeshua. Come alive, prophecy, in this house. I wake up the prophetic in you. I wake up the prophetic in you, intercessors. And your seers will see. Your dreamers will dream. I kickstart your dream cycle right now in the name of Jesus Christ. And when you dream, be sure to write those things down in the journal. Write them down and present them to the woman of God. Because that's how God is going to begin to speak to you concerning the work in this house. Dreams, visions, very spiritual. God is going to begin to speak spontaneously in the middle of service, a prophetic word. Deliverance is going to happen. And I see some of y'all cutting your eyes at the pastor. Don't look at her, look at me. It's right, it's the word. Amen. God is getting ready to do some things in and through you. And you've been, oh my God, woman of God, the Lord says that I am with you. Oh my God. got your son. Don't worry about your son. God's got him. God's got him. He's got him.
Yeah.
You're praying and you're praying and you're hoping God's got him.
Thank you, God.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God Almighty is in the house. Let me tell you something. The Lord is going to get man of God. You a deacon, preacher, elder? I'm going to tell you right now, I don't know you, but I can tell right now that the Spirit of the Lord is strong and mighty upon you and on your life. And the Lord says that I want you to begin to pray like you've never prayed before and pray specifically for the woman of God in this house. You have something. You're a warrior. You're a warrior. Ah, I see
you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Psalmist. 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 I heard you singing. But see, there was more than just, you know, your vocal acrobatics that you did, which you're very good at. But there's an anointing there to set the captives free.
Yeah.
And the Lord says that I'm going to use what you have, what I've given you, said the Lord, and I'm going to begin to break chains that the enemy has placed on the people. He's going to begin to break the chains from the anointing that comes out of your mouth. Commit your way unto the Lord and watch him. Watch him. Watch him. Hallelujah. God says that I'm going to do a brand new thing. Hallelujah. You, man of God, I see you. And I see you standing in front of a building. I see a car. I don't know if you're a business owner, but there is business in you. There's business in you. Whatever it is that you, look, I don't know where you work, but you should have people working for you. There is skill in your hands. God is saying, I'm going to give you a vision. You've already had some ideas about some things. God says, I want you to begin to work toward those things. And when you do it, you want to see the hand of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
You want to see it. There's business in you. It's in you. Business, not just to work for a man. You need to work for yourself. That's where your financial freedom is going to come from. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter what doctors say. It doesn't matter. You can work. You will. Hallelujah. Doors are opening. Doors are opening. They are. Matter of fact, I release the anointing for grace in your life.
Yeah.
I open heaven over you right now in the name of Yeshua the Messiah. And I command the blessing of the Lord upon your life. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Ah, my God, my God, my God. Hallelujah. God wants me to let you know that he has seen the things that you have gone through. He said that I don't want you to worry one bit.
Hallelujah.
Don't even worry about it.
Thank you, God.
He sees. He knows what's going on.
Thank you.
Situations, some things have been kind of messy. But God says, I'm straightening it out this whole night. You are in the right place at the right time because there's an anointing to kickstart a new thing in your life. And your family. Unity. Peace in your family. I speak it right now. Hallelujah. 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 Yes. You know what? Are your children here? Where are your children? Oh, I know that one looks just like you right there. That's your son right there? I met him outside. Amen. God says, I'm going to bless your house.